Hey everybody, welcome all those here, all those listening on live stream today. We are so excited that you guys are here. Stand up, all those in the building. We are going to sing some songs together. Everybody. Everybody has trials and temptations. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation. We can lay, but we can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. What a friend! What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, his heart is my home. Everybody, let's sing it. Everybody has fears, everybody got worries. Everybody knows sorrow, devastation. But we can lay our burdens down, but we can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. Let's sing it. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, his heart is my home. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. He fills me up and my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. How he is proving it over and over. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. He fills me up and my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. How he is proving it over and over, over and over. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, his heart is my home. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, his heart is. Sing it again. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, his heart is my home. Forever and ever, his heart is my home. Forever and ever, his heart is my home. Woo! Let's keep singing.
Sing, let's sing it. Tell you, it is so good to hear voices singing, worshiping in this place once again. So glad to see all of you looking great. Hope you're enjoying this bright, beautiful day. God is good, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord. If you're a guest with us today, let me say welcome. So glad that you are here. If you would help us to get acquainted with you, we'd appreciate that, and you could do that by just grabbing the communication card that's in the chair rack in front of you and just filling that out, letting us know who you are. We have a no-hassle guarantee. We promise not to hassle you. We just like to get connected, get to know you. And you can stop by the Welcome Center on the way out today. We have a gift we'd like to put in your hands and answer any questions you might have about Southern Lakes Church. You can also use that card, obviously, for prayer requests. Let us know other things that are going on to communicate with us. We'd love that. Well, we love to celebrate things around here, and one of the things we want to celebrate today is the fact that we're live streaming for the very first time, so can we give some praise to God for that? All right. That does not mean you get to stay home and, you know, stay in your jammies and all the rest of that. This is for the people that really need that, right? But we're thankful we can do that. We'd also like to celebrate what God is doing in our kids area, and especially, I want to make this announcement, hold your applause till the end, but I want to make this announcement that we are going to have our own Awana Club this fall. Let me just explain for the background, those of you who may not know, we have been doing Awana together with Briggs Road Church here in Elkhorn, and that's been a great partnership over the years, but as time has gone on, our kids have kind of overtaken all of that because we have a ton of kids. And we've kind of been in the driver's seat more and more, but we haven't been in the driver's seat. And so we made a decision in the best interest of Southern Lakes and going forward that we are going to have our own Awana Club. And so we're officially chartering as our own club this fall, putting all the pieces in place for that. Lynn is working very diligent to get all of that ready. We're hoping it's going to kick off in a great way. Coronavirus hopefully cooperating with all of that, but we'll see. We'll make adjustments as needed. But we're going to have our own club, and we're also going to move it from the middle school where it was being held and some of the restrictions and constraints we had there and bringing it back to our facility here. And so on Wednesday night, we're going to have the Awana Club here. And so let's give God a big praise for all of that. Those of you who are marking your calendar already, it's 6 to 7:30 will be the time for that. Moved up the time a little bit because of school nights and so forth. And that also means that the youth that normally met on Wednesday night and used the building, they are going to move and shift to Tuesday night. Thank you for your flexibility in all of that. And the other bonus, if you would, in all of that is the youth then can serve in Awana, whereas before they were both the same night. And we feel very strongly about the necessity of serving. That's how our youth, you say, why do youth lead the church and they're not part of things any longer? In my experience, a lot of it is because they never took ownership. They never got involved. And serving is a great way to do that. And I know that really helped my kids growing up and having leadership and serving in an Awana Club. So we want to encourage all of our youth as well, middle and high school kids, to serve in Awana on Tuesday night if they can, and come to youth on Wednesday as well. And see some great things happen there. So praise God for all of that. One other thing we want to celebrate today, and most of you would not know about this, so I'm just going to highlight it, is a special gift that we've been able to give out of our mission budget. We had an overage in our budget, which allowed us to do this, but Tim and Julie Nelson contacted us from Honduras and let us know that Camp Cali was really in a tight spot. They normally have funds that come in and help support things by having groups that would visit and pay to stay at the camp and use their facilities, but that all dried up when coronavirus hit and they shut down. They locked down really tight to the point where you could just basically go to the store and maybe that's it, and they had guards at the crossroads and, you know, you couldn't do anything else. And so that just cut their business out completely, but they still had overhead. And it's kind of interesting, their overhead and Tim put together this detailed budget of $350 a month, the overhead for the camp. But he had it broken down even to how much for gas for the lawnmower. I mean, very specific, and they didn't want to ask, and they asked, hey, could we, you know, maybe forward some money from our next missions trip to them and so forth. But we prayed about it. We thought, hey, let's not do it that way. God has blessed us through your faithful giving, your generous giving to the last missions trip and so forth, and we had money still left over. And so we went ahead and made them a gift of $1,000 and 50 plus some other charges and so forth, which is going to help float their boat for 3 months. So can we just praise the Lord for that? I know it means a lot to them, and it means a lot to me to see the generosity of this church. And even since we've been back gathering over the last 3 weeks, we've seen, you know, the offerings really take a bounce back and people just really giving and being generous. We've been very blessed in this coronavirus time that most people, at least that I've heard anyways, have not lost their jobs and haven't been put on furlough and so forth. And so we're just very optimistic about all of that and what God is doing. So let's keep praying for one another in regards to that. Normally we would take an offering right now, and let me just let you know, we're not passing the physical plate at this point, but we have boxes in the back. If you'd like to give a cash gift or a check, there's some envelopes back there as well. Just put them in the boxes. We'll get it that way. The best way to give, though, is online, and you can take care of that at any time. Download our app. That's an easy way to do it as well, or go on our website, and it's a great way to give online. If you'd like to give specifically towards the Vision Fund, which is helping us with the live streaming, we've been talking about that, then just earmark that for Vision Fund, and we'll get that as well. So I would like to pray with you this morning, but let me just read a little scripture and set this up a bit. A lot going on in our nation right now, right? A lot happening in terms of demonstrations, riots, all kinds of things. You'd have to have your head buried in the sand to not know what all that was happening the past week or so. And I haven't felt led to specifically address it, like take a whole service and, you know, preach on this or whatever at this point. I might, I don't know yet. But I did want to just comment briefly and just say this. I think the answer is found in seeking God. And what our nation needs more than anything, you know, not this fighting going back and forth, the name-calling and rioting and looting and all these bad things that are happening. The wrath of man, the Bible says, does not produce the righteousness of God. We don't need that. What we need is we need to seek God. We need revival in our land. And so let me read this from James chapter 4, beginning in verse number 8 down through 10. James said, "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament, mourn, and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up." What we need to do individually, what we need to do as a church, what we need to do as a nation is we need to humble ourselves before God. And we need to allow these events, the coronavirus, all the racial unrest, the death of an innocent person, all these things to motivate us to seek God as never before. Would you pray with me? Father, we come before you today, humbling ourselves, realizing we don't have the answers. We can't in and of ourselves fix anything. We need you. And so God, forgive our sins. Forgive our prejudices. Forgive our hatred. And God, we pray that you do a work in our collective hearts and give us love. Give us gratitude. Give us understanding. Give us unity. Help us, Lord, to go forward on our knees and to recognize you and put you in your rightful place. May you bless our nation, Lord, but may we truly seek after you so that you might be able to do that. We pray for peace at this time. We pray for justice. We pray for understanding. God, we need you, and we just recognize you in the midst of all of this. And it's in Jesus' name we pray this. And all God's people together said, amen.
Thank you, Ken. So before we continue singing this morning, I just want to let you know one more announcement for all of us. We are still in need of volunteers. This summer especially, because of all kind of the transition from being online only and now being some services, we have a lot of needs, both in our tech booth. As many of you know, again, we started live streaming today. Hopefully you're listening online. We also have many needs in our children's ministry. We have something called 3x3. We're sort of introducing it this summer, where for the next 3 months, we'd love you to take the opportunity to serve, maybe only for this summer. It's kind of like a no-hassle thing. You can just serve for 3 times, once in June, once in July, and once in August, in those different areas. See if maybe you want to continue, and if you don't, that's totally okay. It's just to kind of help us out through the summer months. If you're interested in that, you can fill out your communication card right in the chair in front of you, or online there's a communication card available on our website as well. With all of that, I stand, and we will continue to sing.
Yeah. to those around me
and sing, I will build my life.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. And I will now,
one more time, sing, I will build my life.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not be shaken.
Will you pray with me? Father, thank you so much that we can come here as your people, whether we're in person here, or we're listening or watching or participating from another source, from another place. Father, we thank you that as your church, we can come together and we can be reminded that you are the foundation that we are to build upon. Your love, your grace, your truth. That in every word that comes out of our mouths, every action, ultimately brings you glory, because you are the one we live for. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name that we do pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning again. Let me just start by addressing the elephant in the room, not Josiah, the screen right there. And yes, this is new, and it's our first Sunday dealing with this, and so I want to talk to you about my new toy, I mean tool, that we have going on here. And you say, you know, what's that all about? What do we need that for? And let me just tell you why we need it. Let's go ahead to the pictures here. It's so you can keep in touch, you know, with my grandkids and see what's going on here. These are my three youngest grandchildren. I got five total, and this is my grandpa Glory. So this is, you know, kind of what I get to see, and you can see that shining going on in my life a lot of times is because of, you know, the grandkids. So you got to know about the grandkids. This is how we keep in touch with all of that. But actually, there's more to it than that. That would be a want, not necessarily a need, perhaps. A long time ago, I was wanting a teaching screen because I'm a teaching pastor. I like to teach, and this is my chalkboard. This is my blackboard. It's electronic. I can't draw in here, but I can do PowerPoint and show pictures and have a lot of fun with it, and we're going to do that. But we really, you know, couldn't justify the cost, and, you know, do we really need it? And we had some of the lighting issues, and we still have lighting issues, but we never quite pulled the trigger on this. And then coronavirus hit, you know, 3 months ago. It's like, oh, yay, you know? And we began thinking and praying about what that meant for our church and going forward in the future, and just the necessity of putting our services online for people that can't be here or shouldn't be here, and who knows, you know, as future goes on, how long this is going to last and so forth. And so this is part of all of that package of being able to communicate well so people can see what's going on as I talk and see the pictures, and, you know, picture paints a thousand words and all the rest of that, and it'll be very helpful. So I think it's going to be a great tool for all of us to use for communication purposes. So in the end, what this is a blessing in disguise. I mean, it wasn't something we were looking to do right now, just like streaming online. We weren't looking to do that right now, but the coronavirus hit and pushed us forward. And so, you know, we've had to make some adjustments, and now we've got those blessings in disguise. What is a blessing in disguise? A blessing in disguise is usually that thing that we don't initially see. That blessing from God. What we usually see is the trial, the tribulation, the difficulty, the problem in our lives. And we kind of focus on that thing, and we don't see what's kind of coming around the next bend. We don't see how God brings it back around and blesses us until maybe later, and then there's always those blessings in disguise. Now, don't misunderstand me. God doesn't necessarily cause the problems in our lives. He doesn't zap us with cancer. Say, oh, you know, you want to have a really good day? Here you go. He doesn't send that tornado to make people miserable. He doesn't say, oh, the world's kind of, you know, in a lull right now, 2020, you know, let's have a worldwide pandemic. Let's just, you know, mix it up a little bit. That's not what God does. God allows these things in his sovereignty, but also in his sovereignty, he wants to use them in a good way. And in the end, he uses them for our good and for his glory. And that's what we have to keep in mind. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28 says that we know all things work together for what? For good. For those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. So this isn't just for anybody, by the way. This verse gets thrown out there kind of in a generic way. But this is for those who are called according to his purpose, those who love God. And for those who love God and are tuned in with what God's doing in his life, all things work together for good. We don't always understand how that works, but it does, and we got to trust God in that. Another verse that kind of brings some of this forward is Isaiah chapter 61 and verse number 3, where it talks about how God gives us beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. And that's what our God does, even in the midst of trials and problems and pain and agony. There are these blessings in disguise. No one wants to experience pain, but pain is a good teacher, right? Nobody wants to go through bankruptcy, but there could be some lessons. There could be some blessings in disguise, some things that maybe we needed to learn in that process. Nobody wants to experience a worldwide COVID-19 pandemic. Nobody wanted that, right? Still don't. But can God use it? Yes. Can God bring blessings in disguise? Yes. Take a look. Here are just a few blessings in disguise from COVID-19. Dinosaur parades. Hey, were they a thing before? Yeah, I don't think so. But very exciting to see dinosaur parades. How about the next one right here? Lots of people's windows. This is our window at our house. We got all the different kids. This is me, by the way, right here. And Dawn put this all together. What a blessing in disguise. I don't know if we're ever going to get our window back. I mean, it's too beautiful. What do you do with that, you know? And you see that all over the neighborhood, people just showing love and solidarity at this time. Here's the next one. Gas prices, right? All the savings we have, you're driving less, and gas prices came down. That's great, right? Except you're like, well, I'm not commuting now, and that's why the gas price, you know, came down. And you're saving money because you're not going out to eat and all those kinds of things. Here's the next one. Another blessing in disguise. Drive-in movies are making a comeback. How good is that? And how's this right here? Next one. You would never have known it, but the Wisconsin Humane Society says they ran out of cats and dogs during this time. People are sitting around going, what's there to do? I think I'll go out and adopt a pet, you know, and deal with that. And seriously, I didn't make this up. I mean, that's why I have hard evidence right here. And then check this one out here, traffic deaths. You know, people are driving less, traffic deaths are down on a decrease. That's great. And then one last one I want to bring out here. In Wisconsin, this is big news. Breweries and distilleries, they switched over to making hand sanitizer, okay? I don't know if they still are, but I'm like, whoa, there's a blessing in disguise. Amazing. So today we're starting this new series called Blessings in Disguise, and let me just let you in on my prayer. You say, what's it about? When I think about a series and I kind of conceptualize it and I pray over it, it's like, okay, God, what do you want to do through all this? And here are three things that I think God wants to do, and here's my prayer for me and you, that we would adjust our thinking. A lot of times our thinking is not biblical about things, and we get off track, and we have to learn to think like God thinks about trials and difficulties and things that are happening in our lives. And then we have to adjust our attitude. Instead of getting that bad attitude about what's going on, we need to learn to be thankful in all things. We need to learn to give God the glory. We need to look for the positive, which is the last thing. Adjust your focus. That God would help us to adjust our focus to Him, of course, but then off of the negative, stop looking at the downside of everything and see the upside. And that will help you, again, to see these blessings in disguise. And if we'll do that, if we'll adjust our thinking, our attitude, and our focus, it will transform us. It'll transform us from the inside out. Instead of being angry and unthankful and bitter, we're going to be joyful. We're going to be grateful, and we're going to become better. And that's what God wants for us. How much so in a world of chaos that we live in right now? I mean, this world is amazing, right? The time that we are living in, the things that we are going through, and what do we need? We need to adjust our focus. We need to adjust our thinking. We need to adjust our attitude, and then God can do great things to help us make this world a better place. So that's my prayer for the series coming up. And each week what we're going to do is we're going to look at one different major blessing in disguise. There's going to be lots of minor ones that we pull into. And this week, the blessing in disguise we want to talk about is maturity or growth in our lives. And I've heard this from many of you over the past couple of months. It's like, okay, you know, God is using this time to grow me, to stretch me, to change me. I mean, our routines got thrown out the window. Our normal way of doing things, church and everything else, we've had to think differently. And God is using that in a great way in our lives. So I told you I was going to tell you about my grandkids. So here we go. So this is Thorin. He just had his first birthday back in February. And, you know, on a first birthday, you get to do this, right? You got a nice little cupcake there. And eventually the cupcake is where? All over, down and around, and he's getting into it, man. This is good stuff. Well, that's okay when you're 1 year old, right? It should be that way. But how about when you're 21? And you're on a really big date with your girlfriend, and, you know, and you, that's how you eat your cupcake. You know, you're putting it all around, you're putting wearing it in your hair, and it's down on the floor, and, you know, all the rest. You're going to be like, boy, this guy's got a little maturity problem here, right? Well, you see, it's the same with us. God expects us to grow up. You know, when you first come to Christ and you're a baby Christian, then God understands that. He understands that you're just learning to kind of walk in your new faith walk. But there comes a time when you have to grow up and you have to mature. And I'll be honest with you, a lot of Christians don't do that. People get fire assurance, so to speak. They receive Christ and then, you know, I'm all good. And then they stop growing in their life. But part of God's plan for you and part of God's plan for me is for us to continue to grow, to be stretched, to become more like Jesus, to mature in our lives. So we're going to look at a couple of passages today that will help us lay that foundation biblically. James chapter 1. Let's turn there together. James chapter 1. And we're going to see how God uses these trials, and that's the blessing in disguise. You got all these problems and difficulties, but the blessing in disguise is God has a purpose and a plan that's greater than all that, and He helps us to mature, to become like His Son Jesus. So, James chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, please follow along as I read. James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Look at verse number 2. James says, count it all joy. Wow. Okay, I'm having trials, I'm having tribulations, I'm having problems, COVID-19, whatever it is. I'm supposed to be joyful about this? Why? Because God's got a purpose. God's got a plan. He wants to bring about maturity. There's blessings in disguise that are there. He goes on to say, when you fall into various trials, it's not a matter of if, but it's a matter of when. You're going to have troubles. We all have them. We go through crisis and calm and difficulties and times of testing. We all have, that's part of life. God said to expect trials. Jesus said in this world, John 16, verse 33, you will have tribulation. Mark it down. It's coming. It's going to happen. That's part of living, folks. But there's a purpose in all that. There's a greater purpose in all of that. The phrase fall into does not suggest an accident, but it means to encounter or to come across. And so in the normal course of life, we are encountering, we're coming across difficulties, trials, things that can be painful, sickness, accidents, disappointments, tragedies, and even pandemics. And we can't always expect everything to go our way. And so then in verse number 3, that's why he says, knowing that the testing of your faith produces what? Patience. Patience? Oh, wow. We all need it, but nobody wants to go through the process of getting patience. And so the testing of our faith here is what brings about patience. Patience, according to the Bible, though, is not this passive acceptance of the circumstances where we're like, okay, I'm going to get through this. You know, I'm going to just patiently wait it out. No, patience, according to the Bible, is more of a perseverance. It's a courageous perseverance in the face of suffering and difficulty. And so we go through this thing, and we go through it victorious, and we go through it persevering to the end, not giving up, becoming stronger, if you would. And God uses the trials to make that happen. Now, I wish, but it doesn't work this way, I wish we could just read a book on patience. Or just hear a sermon on patience. Or just pray and say, God, please give me patience. That's a dangerous prayer, by the way. And all those things can help. Reading a book or hearing a sermon or praying about patience and so forth. But where we really learn patience, where we really learn perseverance, is in the school of hard knocks. We have to go through here to get there. It's in the midst of those trials, those difficulties and sufferings that we learn to trust God in new and wonderful ways. And we find out who God is and we find out who we are. And that's that growth process in our lives. From the Bible, Job is a great example that we often look to this because there's a whole book of the Bible on this, Job. And Job, if you recall, he had an amazing trial. And he was tested and he lost everything. He lost his 10 children. He lost his wealth. He was a very wealthy man. He lost it all, and he lost his health. And he went through an amazing health trial that was going on and all that he had to struggle with. But he had the right perspective in all that. Job chapter 23 and verse number 10, here's what he said. He said, but he, that is God, knows the way that I take, that when he has tested me, when he has tested me, I shall come forth as gold. You see, God tests us, get this right now, God tests us for the purpose of bringing out the best in us. Satan, on the other hand, will tempt us to bring out the worst in our lives. And so God will test us just like he tested Job, and we will come forth as gold if we have the right perspective. Look at verse number 4. He said, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So let patience have its perfect work. The word perfect there in the Greek is teleos, and it means mature. And that's where this whole thing comes into is God's will for our lives, his desire is that we would become teleos Christians, that we become mature believers, that we would grow up more and more. And so here's how the process works according to James. If you just lay it all out here, the trials that come, and we all have them, lead to this patient perseverance in our lives, and we go through that, and if we have the right attitude, we trust God in the midst of that, and we have a learner's attitude, we grow, and it's going to eventually lead to what? It's going to lead to maturity in our lives. That's how it works. That's God's plan. By the way, what is maturity? What is maturity? Well, yeah, maturity is being responsible. It's making wise decisions. But ultimately, it's living our lives according to God's word. Immaturity is the opposite of that, where we're not making wise decisions. We're being foolish, if you would. We're not functioning our lives according to God's word. We're being irresponsible, those kinds of things. If you were to sum up maturity in one word, what would it be? Or go back to Sunday school. Okay, what's always the right answer? Jesus. There we go. If you were to sum up maturity in one word, what would it look like? It would look like Jesus. And that's what God wants for us. He wants us to grow up to be more and more like his son, Jesus, because he was perfection. And how are you going to get to know Jesus? Let me just encourage you here. This is how you study the life of Jesus. You get into the word, and you see how Jesus interacted with people and the questions that he asked and how he answered those questions and the things that he did and how he showed love. And then you imitate that. But that's what God's doing in our lives. He's growing us. He's helping us to become more like his son. How many of you like car problems? Like when your car breaks down and stuff? Okay, I had somebody in the first service that was a mechanic, you know, go figure. Not a lot of fun, right? Over the years, you know, we had what we called kind of the Brummel used car lot at our house, you know, with all of our kids, and we've always driven used cars. For us, it's point A to point B, and somehow God always gets us there. And I've had lots of junkers over the year, and they'll go for a while and they'll die and all the rest of that stuff. And I remember early on in this whole process, I mean, one time we had six cars that had an average of 200,000 miles on them. I mean, it was just really bad. Our neighbors were probably ready to call the police, you know, on the used car lot at our house. But you get to this place where you start seeing it happen, you know. The car breaks down, kind of like this one right here. This was my Saturn. I loved this Saturn. It was amazing. I think it was a 93 Saturn. It was tremendous until I hit an 8-point buck. Or I should say the 8-point buck hit me. I didn't do it on purpose. He just came out of nowhere and he smashed up my nice car and ruined it all there. And what happens? You get irritated at that. You don't like it. It's a trial. It's a difficulty. And what usually happens with our cars, and what happened with our cars, is we take them into the mechanic, and then you'd get that phone call, or you'd go in to check on it, and they'd say, are you sitting down? Yeah, okay. Well, the bad news is it's going to cost about $3,000 to fix your car. It's like, really? You look it up on Blue Book, and it's worth $500, you know, if it was in good shape. And you're like, I'm not throwing bad money after good. And then you pronounce death. I don't know if you've ever had to bury a car, but I've had to bury many cars. We don't literally bury them. We just get rid of them. And so that's how it works. But, you know, I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but after a while, I kind of pick up on things. And I started to see this, you know, I'd get irritated about the car problems and the thing was going downhill, but then, you know, the car would die and I'd have to pray and say, God, I don't have any resources. How am I going to get from point A to point B? And lo and behold, God would provide a new car. And I started figuring out, wow, the new car is way better than the old car. And look what God did. That's amazing. So when my car started to die, after a while, I started getting excited. Because I knew I was going to get a newer, better car. You know what I'm talking about? You see, that's how it works in our lives. Blessings in disguise. We don't want all those trials and difficulties, but God will use them. And God's up to something good, and he's often up to something better. Amen. He's up to something better. We don't see it. And we may not even see it this side of heaven, I'll be honest with you, okay, with all these things. But eventually we will, and we'll see how God is up to something better. And part of that better is he's growing us. He's helping us to become more like Jesus in our lives. That's what James is talking about here. How do you view trials in your life? Do they make you angry? Do you get upset? Do you, you know, just fret over it? Do you worry? Do you get a bad attitude? Just remember, God is up to something good. Say that. God is up to something good. I know it's hard when you're in the middle of a trial and something happens and your car breaks down or, you know, your refrigerator dies and, you know, you got to buy a new refrigerator or appliance or, oh, it's, why? Why me, Lord? But just remember, God's up to something good and he'll see you through. He'll take care of all that. Well, that's what James has to say. Paul compliments James, so turn with me to Romans chapter 5. We're going to look at another passage here, Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5 there as well. Where now Paul is talking about the same thing, very similar, just in a little different way. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Please follow along. Therefore, having been justified by faith, We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now, hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. So here Paul is saying basically the same things that James just told us, just in a little different language. James says, count it all joy, whereas Paul says, glory in your tribulation. It's a different way of saying that. I'm going to glory, I'm going to be happy about my tribulation. Why? Again, because in this case, the trials produce suffering, and the suffering produces godly character, and the godly character produces hope. So this is how it works again. We got these trials and tribulations, difficulties of life, and they lead to perseverance. And by the way, interesting note here, the word James used, and maybe your translation has consistency here, but the word James used for patience is the same Greek word here. I don't know why the New King James translated it that way, but it's context. And so perseverance, it's the same thing. It's this patient perseverance. So tribulations lead to perseverance. And that perseverance, as we work through it, it leads to what? It leads to a godly character in our lives. The Greek word for character there has the idea of testing. And when God tests us through our tribulations, what it does is it brings out this godly character in our lives. And that godly character then leads to hope. And who doesn't need hope? Hope keeps us positive. Hope keeps us looking to God. Hope keeps us looking to the future, and that's that maturity process. So again, that's what God does. That's how God does it. He brings the difficulties or allows the difficulties in our lives to eventually bless us in disguise with maturity. Now, one of the things that I love to do is hear how God is working in people's lives. I mean, that's what keeps me going, change lives. And so, you know, thank you. Many of you have written to me, emailed me, and said, you know, thank you for doing sermons online and some things and how God's been working in my life. I just love hearing that. Let me just share a couple of blessings with you that I heard along the way of just how God was maturing people. And I think you can appreciate this along with me. Here's the first one, short one. The second one's longer. First one says, your message was spot on for me today. I finally found out what I need to do. I need to redefine failure. Thanks for doing these online sermons for us. So just a short little blessing. You know, somebody took that thing out, and just like I had shared in my life several weeks ago, you know, how God used failure in my life to help me to move forward and be successful in his eyes, this person saw that same thing and shared that with me. That's growth. Praise God for that. Here's another one, a little bit longer. Thank you for teaching God's word each week online through this season of life. I wanted to share with you what the Sunday message of sharing God's love, the good news with others, did for me. I was so moved that I baked zucchini bread for 5 neighbors. I mean, that's how you can tell that the sermon really gets down there, is you zucchini bread. I put a note card on them with John 3:16 written out, and then on the back an invitation to join us online, leaving them on their doorsteps with a wave of thank you in the window. I also had some of my grandchildren make cards with verses for 50 residents that I delivered to my mom's senior living. And now, with the permission of the manager, get this, with the permission of the manager, I'm going to start a little newsletter called The Good News, which will include scriptures, stories, jokes, all of which will be written by my grandchildren. My hope is to let seniors know that we care about them at this time, and perhaps they will feel God's love in the good news. Thank you again for your encouragement of finding ways / opportunities to get around those obstacles in our lives to share Jesus. I mean, that encourages me. It encourages me when I see growth in your lives and the maturity that comes about, and we handle those trials and difficulties in a way that God lets us. So that's why this has been a reoccurring theme over the last several months, that when life hands you lemons, what do? Okay, lemons, more lemons, we got them. Some people, you just get it piled on, it's like getting avalanched with lemons. You got to make lemonade. Because why? That's God's way. And if we learn to do that, that lemonade is going to be that blessing in disguise. It's going to be maturity in our lives. So here are two, just real quick, bonuses I want to cover off on all this. The first one is drawing closer to the Lord. You see, when we go through a difficult time, we've got a choice. We can either run to God or we can run from God. Which one do you think is going to turn out better? Running to God, obviously. So when we go through a difficult time, you know, some people blame God, they get mad at God. That doesn't do any good. We have to cooperate with God. We got to let God work in our lives and let that trial draw us closer to God in prayer and just who God is and driving us to his word and so forth. The other part of this is sometimes God uses the trials in our lives to just bring us initially to him and his son and what Jesus has done for us. Go back to our passage, Romans chapter 5 and verse number 1. It says this, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Where is true peace found? It's found in the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. And so if you don't know Jesus, you don't have peace. No Jesus, N-O Jesus, no peace. But if you know Jesus, K-N-O-W, you will know, K-N-O-W, peace. And that's why he died on the cross, so we could be reconciled to God and have our sins forgiven and enter into a relationship with Jesus. And one of the blessings in disguise, the trials, and God will use them in our lives, is to bring us to himself. I've heard so many stories that way. I wasn't looking to God, and I didn't need God because everything was going great, and then all of a sudden, boom, this happened in my life, and then, you know, my focus changed. And so that's a blessing there. So if you don't know the Lord Jesus, and you're going through some trials and difficulties right now, that's what God wants to do. He wants to bring you to himself. He wants to draw you near so he can have a relationship with you. Maybe you've already given your life to Christ. It works the same way, though. He wants to continue to use that circumstance to draw you to himself. And we can resist it, but it's not going to do any good. Here's another bonus in all of that, and that is to leveraging our experience to bless others. God doesn't waste the opportunities that we go through, the experiences in our life. He wants us to leverage them to help and bless others as well. So 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 talk about this. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation." Why? "That we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." You see, God allows us to go through stuff, but then he wants to use that stuff to mature us in our lives and then to bless other people as well. You know that. You've experienced it as you've received, and you've experienced that as you've given out to others as well. Who better to minister to somebody who's a drug addict that's struggling with that than somebody who's gone through it? Who better to minister to somebody who's lost a loved one than somebody who has lost a loved one and they know what they're going through? Who better, when you think about this, somebody who's gone through marital trials and difficulties or maybe a divorce, to help somebody that's going through those same things if they've learned from those experiences? Whatever it is in our lives, fear or worry or discouragement, if you've gone through that, God wants to use that now in your life to bless others as well. As you heal through it, as you mature, and that's what we do as we mature, we pass that on to others. And that's what God wants to do. He doesn't waste the opportunities. Let me share how that worked in my life a little bit. I've not shared this story before, at least not publicly with you, because it's kind of painful, to be honest. But God has been teaching me. And people look at my life and say, "Oh, Pastor Ken, you're so blessed." And I am. I am so blessed. But God does the same thing in my life as yours. And there's been a lot of trials and tribulations and difficulties that God has used to mature me. And one of those happened in the year 2000. I was pastoring a small church, and we were trying to save money. And so I was helping out with some of the work around there, and we were trimming the trees in the back of the church. And I was up on a ladder, about 16 feet up on the ladder, and some of you probably know where this is going already. I had a chainsaw in my hand, and I was cutting off the limb that I was standing on. No, I'm just kidding. It wasn't that bad, okay? I wasn't standing on the limb. I was standing on the ladder. I was cutting off the limb about that big around, and somehow it snapped prematurely. It was weird how this whole thing happened. And it kind of got hung up, and the base of that branch came down and it hit the ladder. And I mean, the chances of this happening are very slim, but it happened. It hit perfectly in the middle of the ladder, bowed this nice aluminum ladder, and knocked the ladder out. And so what happened to me? I went flying. I let the chainsaw go, and I landed on the hard dirt on this side of my body. Fortunately, I missed the lawnmower that was laying right there. Crashed my whole left rib cage. I broke so many ribs, they wouldn't even tell me how many I broke. The ribs went through and punctured my left lung, which collapsed my lung, and then I had internal bleeding. It knocked me out when I hit the ground. My father-in-law was there. My second oldest daughter was there. They had to witness that. Very difficult, because it just about killed me. And I came to the most pain I'd ever known in my life. It was terrible, and I was just kind of scraping in the ground, just moaning and... And fortunately, they were able to call the ambulance. The ambulance was there within a couple of minutes. They put me on a backboard, and they, you know, nice ambulance ride to the hospital to save my life. Got to the hospital, got into the emergency room, and this is another fun little side story there. And they told me they had to go into my body to help drain because I had all this internal bleeding and stuff. They had to drain me out. And there wasn't time to put you under, and that's just not how they do this and so forth. So this was the understatement of the year. They said, you're going to feel a little discomfort. If you ever hear that, run, okay? And I should have known because they had several people around the bed that were just like there to hold me down. And so they cut me open right here. I got a nice little scar right there. And they took this little half, like about half inch clear tubing, and it was cut off like at a 45 degree angle, very sharp and rigid tubing. And they put that in there, and the way they get it from there to, you know, inside your rib cage to where it needs to drain, is they use that tubing to cut its own path. So they put it in there, and it's like, ripping through here. And I had never had anything in my body cavity before, and I could feel it going right by my heart. And I'm like freaking out. This was the most pain I'd ever experienced. I didn't know you could have that much pain. Okay? Later on, they told me most people pass out during that. And I'm like, well, why didn't you tell me ahead of time? I could have done that, you know? But no, I stayed awake through the whole process, you know? So they finally got that in there. Make a longer story shorter. I spent 5 days in the hospital. It was amazing. I got like 15 hours of sleep in 5 days. And then I eventually got to go home where I slept in an easy chair for 4.5 months because I couldn't even lie flat on a bed. It took that long to just get straightened out enough. I had to learn how to walk all over again. I'm fortunate to be alive. I could have been paralyzed. God has been so good to me. Thank you. And God's got a purpose in all of that, right? And part of the purpose and the reason I'm telling you that is this. There's some things that God had to teach me that I needed to learn that I don't think I would have learned any other way. I wouldn't have signed up for it, but that's how it works. I'm much more compassionate now than I was. Now, I'm not there yet. I got a long way to go. I'm trying to learn, God. Don't do that again, you know. But I'm much more compassionate. Every time I make a hospital call, it's a different ballgame now than it used to be. I'm so thankful when I walk out of the hospital, and I always thank God for that. But I know how to minister to people better in the hospital because I've been there. God is teaching me patience and teaching me how to listen and to slow down and to count my blessings and to be thankful and all these things. You see, folks, that's maturity. And it doesn't come about easy. It's a blessing in disguise. So think about your own life today. Make a little application as Josiah and we're going to get set up here for a song here we're going to have at the end. But what are you going through? What is your heartache, loneliness, fear, physical pain, loss? What is it? I just want you to know that God loves you. And he wants to comfort you through that pain. He wants to comfort you through that loss. And he wants you to become more like Jesus, if you'll let him in your life. Go back to the threefold prayer or the goal for this series. What does God want us to do? He wants us to adjust our thinking about all of this and think biblically. He wants us to leverage all of this and have a good attitude, be positive, give thanks for things, and to focus. Focus more on him and focus on the goodness of God and what he's doing in our lives rather than the downside. What are those blessings in disguise? So what if? What if all the difficulties you're experiencing have a greater purpose? What if? What if the storms, the disappointments, the pains of this life are all just really blessings in disguise? Laura Story wrote a great song about this that just ties in very well, and Sarah's going to sing that for us today. Please listen to the words as we go through.
The storms, the heart.
pray with me? Dear Lord, we give you the glory for what you're doing in our lives. We pray that you would help us to see your blessings in disguise, that we would grow through these experiences, that we would help others, that you, Lord, would become closer to each of us. Thank you for what you're doing in each of our lives. I pray for those today that might be especially suffering and struggling. God, may they know that you're near, that you love them, that you want to bring about joy, that you want to bring about hope in their lives. May they feel that you are near. May they feel that hope, the comfort of the God of comfort. For those who don't yet know you, Lord, I pray that they'd open their heart to you today and receive you as their Lord and Savior, so that they also might have hope and comfort and joy. Father, we love you. We thank you for your love, your faithfulness in our lives. We pray that you would be free to continue your work now in each of our lives individually as well as corporately in our church. And all God's people together said, amen. Amen. Well, if you made a decision today, we'd love to hear about that. If you're online, you can let us know about that. There's an electronic version of the communication card online. We'd love to hear about your decision and rejoice with you if you received Christ or made some other step of growth in your life. We'd love to hear about it. And let me just say this, too. As I look forward to this series of hearing about blessings in disguise, would you take some time, maybe this next week or two? All of you don't have to do this, but if you feel led of God, would you just email me? It's just kbrummel@slefc.org. If you would just email me and let me know a blessing in disguise that you have experienced during this coronavirus over the last 3 months, during this pandemic, that would be great. If I use what you said, I'll change the name to protect the guilty. Believe me, I'll do that. But would love to hear from you in that regard and rejoice with you in what God's doing in your life. Next week, we're going to move on to another blessing in disguise, and it's clarity. You'll have to come back, and it'll be more clear next week, I'm sure, with all that. Let me ask you to stand, and we're going to dismiss you with the final blessing. And just remember again, I've noticed as I've been out and about in some areas this week, people are beginning to act like the coronavirus doesn't exist any longer. And on the one hand, that might be good because we're getting back to some normalcy. But on the other hand, it still does exist. So let's continue to have a lot of respect for one another here in our congregation and practice social distancing. It's a beautiful day. Take it outside, fellowship, those kinds of things. And continue to just respect one another. Don't get mad at me if I don't shake your hand. I've had people do that. It's not because I don't like you. I mean, I got somebody was really offended the other night when they stuck out their hand. I said, well, you know, oh boy, it's really hard. The next guy comes up and just out of habit, I shook his hand. I said, I better shake your hand now. So I'm shaking everybody's hand. So that's how it works. So just continue to be respectful and all that. Let me leave you with this blessing. May the God of all comfort comfort you in your tribulation, that you may know his love, his grace, his hope, his joy in the midst of all of this, and that you may pass all of that on, all that love to others this coming week. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.